Hello and welcome to Trinity University in Washington, D.C. for the 2012 Elite Showcase Basketball Classic. I'm Jeremy Huber, joined by my partner, UVA standout Junior Burrow. And Junior, we've got a game where we're going to see all kinds of big-time stars from big-time universities coming up. Really excited for this one. I'm sure you are, too.
I'm definitely excited about it. The thing about it that I'm most excited is to see, you know, you have all these schools. You have Georgetown represented, George Washington, some of the local schools, obviously. And you want to see these kids and see how they play, because they're going to fit in. Are they going to fit in? How talented are they? How athletic are they? All those kind of things you want to get an opportunity to see. Plus, show the fans a little bit of something to look forward to in these next couple of years once they get to those schools.
And you also mentioned some of the local schools, some big-time national schools mentioned as well, with Marquette, Michigan, Kansas among our folks. So it should be a big game. The North team in black, the South team in white, and we are underway here at Trinity as the North team controls the tap.
Something going on with this. Okay, a shoe already. a referee shoe. That's the first.
That is
the first with the referee.
losing shoes. Well, we are underway and taking the ball out of bounds. It'll be Jamal Ferguson for the North team. He's headed to Marquette, and he'll hand it off to Patrick Holiday, a local product headed to George Mason.
And to piggyback what you were talking about earlier, you're not just talking about some of the national schools. These are all NCAA schools. Now we're in the middle of March Madness. All these teams that you just mentioned have just finished playing or are still playing right now. So really excited to see what they're doing.
So Ali Cox with the jumper out of Middleburg Academy in Virginia. He's headed off to VCU and the North on top 2-0.
Got an opportunity to see him play earlier against Landon. Just a big athletic kid that's going to hopefully do really well down there. I mean, it's right up the alley. Just another guy who plays with a motor. Really excited to see him play down there at VCU with Shaka Smart.
Nice outlet pass there by Holloway, looking for the long alley-oop. Couldn't connect it, though. And now the South into the front court, setting up offense.
How these games usually go, you're talking about a lot of good guard play. These are all-star games, so the guards are going to dominate the ball. A little showtime, a little bit of everything here and there. So hopefully some of these big guys can get involved, running up and down the floor, getting some dunks and finishes. Make it an exciting game for everybody.
Nick Stauskas missed that long shot. He's a big-time deep-range shooter. Couldn't get that one to go, and now a turnover and back over to the North side.
A little jittery early. A couple of plays, only one shot at the basket so far for the white team, so we'll see.
Stauskas again headed to Michigan, and obviously John Beilein, a guy who likes those long-range shooters, really key to his offense. North leading 2-0 as the shot up and out, no good. So as Junior said, the jitters early on, not good shooting.
And plus, you didn't get a long time to warm up here. You know, you had a great girls game a little earlier. So, you know, just give the kids a chance to get going, get moving around a little bit.
Zach Elcano, he's committed to American, misses the shot, and quickly into the front court goes the North side. And Cox with the dish and a nice play, one-handed dunk by Andre Washington.
There's our first finish of the day, hopefully a mini more. Some ball movement. It's always nice to see a little bit of extra pass in those games.
And let's get an update, our first of the day, from our sideline reporter, Daniel Zimmet.
I'm here with Aaron Parks of the North team. Aaron, what's it like to be playing in a tournament like this with so many elite players from around the area?
It just feels good and just an honor to play with these guys that's going to the next level. And me as an undersided player, just make me work even harder, because I know that these guys that work hard, and I know I can work hard too. So it just feels good to be here.
Well, good luck in the rest of the game and have fun out there. Back to you guys.
Thank you, Daniel. And a timeout, so I think maybe trying to get some folks adjusted. You don't usually see that in the All-Star games. Kind of let them play a little bit.
Right, right. The thing about it is that it's not what it used to be. You know, you don't have a lot of time with these kids. They're coming from a long way. Some of them are still in school. You don't have the 2 or 3 days of practice and stuff like that like you used to have back when I played in these All-Star games. So you have to do it on the fly. Plus, these coaches don't get an opportunity to get a chance to see them as much as they used to. So you're giving a coach maybe an hour, maybe 30 minutes of practice yesterday, and, you know, you're just trying to get some basic plays down so they don't look crazy out there when they start playing.
You mentioned the coaches, Junior. For the South, it's Walter Webb from Atlantic Shores Christian, has some ties up to the D.C. area. Scott Willard from the Miller School, the leader of the North squad.
Miller School has done well over these last couple of years. You know, obviously down in that Charlottesville area, they've been doing a very good job since even when I was in school down in Charlottesville. So, you know, he's just following the tradition of good players, good coaches.
And a nice block and a putback, no good. Third time won't be the charm either. As the ball knocked around and denied on one end, that was Marshall Wood trying for those three shots, couldn't get them. Now quickly into the front court. and a shot from outside. Holloway looking for three. That one no good, and the South pulls in the rebound.
Now, when you start also, you know, doing interviews with guys that are undecided, you know, this is one of those places where, you know, you can get a guy decided to come to your school. If you're decided, you're already committed to a George Mason or whatever, and you have a couple of players that aren't, you know, undecided and all those things. Maybe he's a point guard and you're a power forward. It always works that way. I can tell you a couple of stories. Chris Webber and Juwan Howard were also recruiting my point guard, Corey Alexander, just to try to get him to come to Michigan at the time with the Fab Five and all that stuff, because he was undecided at the time. And luckily, he came with his power forward to Virginia. But, you know, it's always nice when you have guys that are committed to a school and they can pretty much be the best spokesperson for their school once they're committed.
Yeah, you talk about that, and so many times we really heard about the fact that guys will go ahead and really bring another guy in. You're right, you talk about it. Hey, you know, the coaches can only do so much. The guys who are there playing or guys who are going to be coming and say, hey, we can do this together, really seems to have that bearing on the high school athletes.
Absolutely. It's always that way. I mean, if you have a good chemistry off the court, and it usually helps you on the court. I mean, no matter what anybody says about talent, the best thing to have as a team is chemistry.
And Ali Cox able to knock another one down. He's got four, an 8-0 lead for the North. Again, Cox headed to VCU. He's got a couple guys thinking about playing for the Rams that are here as the ball goes out of bounds. And that's big, though. I don't know if there's any better salesman at the college basketball level right now than Shaka Smart.
Listen, he's done something down there. He's been a long line. Obviously, started with Jeff Capel, then it went to Ty Grant. Now it's Shaka Smart's turn. Then the Final Four from a couple of years ago. Tough loss against Indiana, one of the better teams coming up with Coach Green down there at Indiana. But, I mean, this kid is a phenom. He's strong. He's muscular. He's ready to play right away. And he has a motor. And I think that's what's going to be really helping him at VCU, having that motor on both ends of the floor.
And around and out. Yeah, you mentioned that. Obviously, the style of play they play with the pressing and getting after people, he'll be big there as the shot up and good. That one by Tillman Dunbar headed to the Naval Academy. So he gets the South squad on the board.
It's a long time for it. You know, it seems like North is playing good defense. Defense in an All-Star game?
8-2 is our score. The North in the black jerseys leading the South in the white. And pass goes out of bounds. And we want to remind you that the Elite Showcase Basketball Classic features many of the premier players in the nation. Visit us at www.esbcbasketball.com. We mentioned some of the best players in the country. Seems like a shift change about to come in for the North squad as the ball knocked away and Holloway comes away with it, looking for the pass. Another alley-oop attempt for Cox, and he brings it down.
That's how he's going to play next year. They're going to be running, dunking, jumping, flying around down at VCU. So he seems to be acclimated to already doing that. You know, you can't ask for a better situation.
Long three-pointer missed. And you mentioned it. He's the guy. He's going to get a chance again. Puts one up off the rim to himself, and he'll slam it back home. So Ali Cox, a standout in this game already.
Absolutely. You know, he's an undersized big man as well. And I tell you what. Once he goes through the training down there, I know you've heard about the Navy SEAL training that the VCU Rams have been through over the last couple of years under Coach Smart. He's going to be ready to go right away as soon as he gets down there. I can't wait to see it.
Daquan Cook with that three, and you mentioned that training. It almost reminds me maybe of a Georgetown or Arkansas way that John Thompson, Nolan Richardson pushed those guys as a shot dunked down by Andre Washington, but really that kind of pushing you to your brink so when the game comes, it's easy.
I mean, that's what it's all about now, especially when you're trying to push up tempo and play that way. I know we had those kind of training camps when I was in college under your guy, Jeff Jones. We had those kind of preseason conditioning, but the ACC was so tough at the time that you just had to be ready to go. You know, you couldn't press like you can now because there's not as much talent standing in college. But the bottom line is you have to be ready to play. And I think those kind of that's also a selling tool for a lot of recruiters now. Listen, this is what we do in the summertime. You're going to be ready to play, skill level and stuff like that. So I'm excited.
Cook has a shot blocked by Stauskas up to Holloway. He'll dunk it on his own. So only 6 points, but he has some up.
I tell you what, the North team is getting high percentage shots here.
They are. 16-7, they're leading over the South squad. North again in the black jerseys as Holloway will take it up and no one's going to be there. He's going to look to lay it up and puts it down. So you're right, high percentage shots. Can't get much better than layups and dunks.
Can't get much better than layups and dunks. And you're looking at Holloway, who's one of the best shooters in the area. For him to be getting layups and he hasn't taken a jump shot yet, that's going to show later. He's going to get him a couple of these looks up. You're going to be able to see why everybody thinks he's the best shooter on the East Coast.
Yeah, he had a huge shot in the city title game earlier this week, knocking really down a dagger three to put away Coolidge in that contest as the shot's blocked, rebound blocked again, and out of bounds, defensive intensity coming from Andre Washington.
Mr. Washington.
He's definitely getting up in 6'10". Definitely a guy who can play and go into Wake Forest, to playing in the ACC, a place that you know very well, and obviously led the late Wake back to where they were when you were playing.
Well, I tell you what, if he can do anything with the Wake Forest that I played against with Tim Duncan, Randolph Childress, and Rodney Rogers and all those guys, and help them get back on track, I tell you what, right now, they're struggling down there, but it's one of the better places to play. It's a great atmosphere for basketball, and he's going to help them get on track. If you're going to be that kind of defensive player, you can stop other teams from scoring, you have a better chance of winning.
Most definitely. Shot from three, no good. Volleyballed around, and Zach Elcano brings it down. He's headed to American University to play for your old coach, Jeff Jones.
I hope he's ready. I mean, that's all you can ask for. You know, Coach Jones, my guy, but.
And a dunk down on the play. We'll send it down to our sideline reporter, Daniel Dimmitt.
I'm here right now with Brandon Bolden of the South team. Brandon, what made you make the decision to go to Georgetown and play for Coach Thompson III?
It just fit my style. I played the best. And I just really love how they treated me on campus. It's a real genuine feeling.
Awesome. Well, good luck in the game today and have some fun out there. Back to you.
Thank you, Daniel. And Mo Ali Cox hitting that three from the outside, showing off his game. On the other end of things, a shot knocked down by Melvin Johnson for three. So we're starting to see the South squad get their rhythm.
Get a little rhythm. You get some of the cobwebs, butterflies out. You know, even though, you know, like I said before, it's not always about the crowd and all this stuff. Sometimes you got to get yourself going into it. Seems like the South is finding it.
Shot up and no good. Rebound, though, by the North squad and put back up and in by Ethan Savage. So now 23-12, the North in the lead.
You know, Daniel said something, Mr. Bolden said something key. When on his visit to Georgetown, it was a family atmosphere. And that's exactly what you got to have a lot of times on these recruiting trips now. You got to have a family atmosphere. We'll see. You know, can he play down there?
Yeah. And some more showtime for the North squad. White bringing down the dunk and no good on the shot. Actually, on that dunk, it was Aaron Parks with the dunk shot, and now back looking for some more showtime. Up and off the glass and in for Frank Mason. The timeout will be called, and Mason, he's headed to Towson University. And Junior, really Towson, one of those interesting stories on the college recruiting scene where they had the losing record, couldn't get a game, win a game, I believe, for almost 2 years, but really pulling a pretty good recruiting class, I believe, by just kind of promising playing time. And that's important for a young player to go in and know from day one you can get a spot in the starting lineup if you're up to it.
And everybody wants to know their opportunity to play at the next level. And if your school, whatever it may be, if you get an opportunity to play, people will see you. And that's just the bottom line. And I think right now, I've watched Townsend play a couple of times this year, and even though they were losing those games, you have to look at them and say, hey, this team is playing hard. They're a couple of pieces away from winning games. You can't get caught up in the schedule, who you're playing. They played a tough schedule. We'll see. I mean, I think they're going to have a better chance this year of winning some games, obviously more than they won last year, the last couple of years. But you got to credit the coaching staff for staying positive over there and doing a great job of keeping some of this local talent around.
Most definitely. And you mentioned it. One thing that has helped them a little bit, unlike when you were in school and, you know, the ACC is a team that was always there. Now the CAA getting some television. You see them on ESPN a good bit. So really, if you play anywhere at a decent level, you're going to get a chance to be seen on TV.
You're going to get a chance to get seen. The CAA has done a fantastic job over the last 4 or 5 years of not just taking one school as their champion, but they've done a great job. Obviously, what BCU did was incredible. What George Mason did a few years ago in 97 or 98, I can't remember the year. Old Dominion has been fantastic. JMU has done a better job of recruiting and all those things down there at that university. So the whole conference is good. There's no easy wins. There's no, you know, there's a lot of tough places to play. Drexel, Delaware, those schools, just a great job down there. I'm really pleased to see what's going on in those schools. And the CAA is a tough conference now, so we'll see.
Yeah, it's really some big-time basketball played on the East Coast besides the ACC and the Big East. Remember, The Rock is the official basketball of the Elite Showcase Basketball Classic, and that time goes down from three.
You got to call glass. You shoot from the top of the key, you got to call glass, no matter if it's an all-star game or not.
It's funny you talk about that, and one of the old coaches at Virginia after you left, Pete Gillen, always talked about his line on the radio when he does games is, he says the time of the day and the banks are now open. That time it was for Mr. Parks, and the ball blocked out of bounds again by Andre Washington, showing some defensive intensity. He's a guy that can definitely alter shots down there.
I tell you what, if you can stop, like I said earlier, if you can stop other teams from scoring at the level, I mean, if you're watching the NCAA tournament now, some of the better teams, some of the teams that are really still left in, Kansas, Kentucky, Syracuse, some of the better defensive teams, then you have a chance to win. This kid is going to get Wake Forest an opportunity to win games. If not next year, by his sophomore year, develop some more size, some more strength, he'll be able to contest shots at the rim and actually has a decent touch for a big guy. So I'm excited about his future and his chances of being a better basketball player. We'll see. Like I said earlier, I always say we'll see, because it just gives, you know, the kids are doing a great job of just playing hard. That's what we really want. You know, kids are going to play hard, and I think that's the most important part of it. He plays hard.
The alley-oop there by Thomas, Kyle Thomas from Milford Mill Academy of Baltimore. He's undecided, trying to get some more looks from the colleges or figure out where he's going to go. A shot from three up, and that one drops for Frank Mason. So the Towson University future product knocking one down, and now a foul at the other end, as we are seeing some fast and furious action as you'd expect in an All-Star game.
Some of these guys haven't played in a few weeks of organized basketball, referees. There might be a fatigue factor left in this. Some of these guys, you know, just hadn't picked up a ball in a couple days. You know, some of these seasons are longer than AAU season for a lot of kids, so you don't get an opportunity to play as much. So, you know, maybe that's what's going on right now. But obviously chemistry, getting back to it.
Miss on the foul shot by Charles Taylor Jr. Remember, the Elite Showcase Basketball Classic features many of the premier players in the nation. Visit us at www.esbcbasketball.com. Able to knock down the second free throw is Taylor, and now the lead for the North squad, 33-17. Just around 9 minutes left to go in our first half. Playing the 20-minute halves, just like college. Is that a difference? Is that something it takes a little bit getting used to in this type of matchup?
Not to mention the shot clock. A lot of guys aren't, you know, connected to shot clocks. They don't play with them in college. I mean, in high school, in their local high schools. We were talking earlier off the air about Catholic leagues and public schools. A lot of times, that's your difference. You have some schools that don't play with shot clocks. So, you know, they're not used to the up-tempo and getting shots up at a quicker pace. So, you never can tell.
Now Washington steps to the line to shoot two again. He's headed to Wake Forest. And you mentioned that. We saw that, I'm thinking, a little bit in the city title game where Paul the Sixth playing Coolidge. The city leagues in D.C. don't play with a shot clock. The Catholic League does, and you really saw at one point where Paul the Sixth had a big lead, instead of kind of maybe being a little more patient, we're putting shots up at a faster pace, and you think, okay, probably because they're used to doing it in 30 seconds, 35 seconds because of that shot clock.
Well, I tell you what, I had the privilege of going to two Paul the Sixth practices, and when I tell you it is full on, high speed, gasoline, 93 octane, down there, Paul the Sixth down in Fairfax, Virginia. He runs a practice where you can get sweaty just over there watching. Man, it's exciting. And, you know, like I said, they put it all in. They put the work in. Congratulations to them and their coaching staff down there. And they have a bunch of players there, too, as well. It's not just this year. Hopefully, they'll be around for a long time to come.
We're seeing three of them out there today in this matchup as they look for the alley-oop. About to lay that one in, so no showtime, but Brandon Bolden, the product who's headed to Georgetown soon, and quickly the other way, up and good, and no foul called, but a physical move to the basket by number 15, Frank Mason.
I tell you what, this is what All-Star Games are all about, getting the ball up and down the floor, dunks, layups, etc. It's all about that guard play. I mean, Jay, look at it. You know, most of these guards are holding on to the basketball, getting to the basket. You know, it's very hard for a big guy to get a rhythm. But, you know, these are the kind of athletic big guys that you see now in college basketball. So we'll see if this continues, if this run continues.
Knocking around and still getting the rebound. A little contact, but still getting it to go. Aaron Park, I think he took a little elbow off the dome there, but still gets it to go.
Seems like the refs have swallowed the whistle in this All-Star game.
And with our lead for the North at 16 points, we'll go ahead and get an update from Daniel Zimmett.
I'm here with Patrick Holloway of the North team, future George Mason Patriot. Patrick, after winning the city title game just last week, what's it like coming here playing with this elite amount of players?
Well, it feels good. You know, the city title game was a really serious game, so this game, you know, kind of a game we can kick back, you know, just have a good time, you know, enjoy the competition, you know, and play with guys you never played with before. So,
what made you decide to go to George Mason and play for Coach Hewitt?
Just the coaching staff, really. I mean, I felt really comfortable with the coaching staff. You know, they made me feel really good about coming in there and even having an opportunity to play. You know, they didn't promise me anything, which is something I really liked about them. you know, they're real with me, and they told me I have to earn my time like everybody else. But I have a fair opportunity to go there and play, and I like the area, I like the conference, so it was a good look for me.
Well, good luck next year at Mason. Have fun today. Back to you.
And thank you, Daniel. And that's it. That's kind of a refreshing thing, Junior, to hear a guy say, hey, I liked it, the fact that they're not going to promise me anything. A place where you see guys kind of transfer on around looking for their ideal opportunity, a guy says, you know what, I don't care about the competition. I'm going to go earn this spot on my own.
Absolutely. Well, this is one of those kids that's going to earn his playing time. He does a couple of things that you just can't teach. The ball goes in when it leaves his hand. That's the bottom line. Holloway is a fantastic shooter. I think what we should have asked him is that he's been playing with this kind of talent for the last 2 years at Paul DeSix, so this is nothing new for him. Coach Hewitt at George Mason has got himself somebody who's going to keep the defense, because the three-point line, I know you've heard it before, the three-point line has changed college basketball. This kid is going to give George Mason an opportunity to change the way they play. You can't leave it. And it goes in when he shoots it, and that's just the bottom line. There's nothing else you can really say about a guy who can shoot, but when it leaves his hands, it has a chance to go in.
Really, that's an equalizer when it comes to the game of basketball. A guy at the line who's a real equalizer, at least UNLV hoping that way. Daquan Cook knocking down the free throw again from St. Francis Academy in Baltimore, Maryland. And really the guy a lot of people had their eyes on coming into this matchup.
Ooh. He's just one of those kids, a tough, hard-nosed kid, quick as lightning. And he comes out here and he's playing kind of at a pace where everybody else can get a chance to touch the ball. But if you would have saw him playing this in regular high school, he was moving up and down the floor. You can see what UNLV saw him.
Yeah, he's only 6'1", so going to be playing, I think, at the point guard spot as shot up. He's going to get called for the foul as Frank Mason sends him to the line to go ahead and shoot too. But you can see, and it almost seemed like when Mo Ali Cox really got it going early on, that Cook said himself, hey, I got to go ahead and match this. And he ran off a couple buckets on his own to kind of match the intensity there.
And I tell you what, that's the kind of stuff that coaches look at. Who's looking to guard the other team's best player? And who's good and who's hot, who's not? And this shows you Cook is willing to go out there and just give it all on both ends, even in an all-star game. That's what you want to see from your players. And I tell you what, you can't lose a scholarship, obviously, in playing in these kind of games, but you can always gain some press, or, you know, when you're undecided, you can always gain a scholarship because everybody just wants to see you play hard.
Playing hard right now as Frank Mason takes it to the bucket. He's going to get a chance for the old-fashioned three-point play as he puts it in the bucket. Also going to get a chance to give the North Squad a 20-point lead. I want to remind folks that the Elite Showcase Basketball Classic features many of the premier players in the nation. Visit us at www.esbcbasketball.com, and it will be a three-point play for Mr. Mason out of Petersburg High School in Virginia.
I tell you what, I think Townsend might have got a steal here. With Mr. Mason. I mean, you can see it all. You can see the high Division I abilities in him. So I don't know what the sales pitch was, but it seems like it's the same thing with all of them so far that's been interviewed. Coaching staff, comfortable, family atmosphere. Those are the kind of things all these guys are looking for, and I'm pretty sure that's what Townsend gave him.
Again, we talked about Townsend. The playing time may be big when you talk about the fact where they've been and trying to get back. Guys are going to get that chance to really help turn that program around as freshmen. And now, a little bit of miscommunication there for the north side by Ferguson and Cox. I think Cox thought Ferguson was taking it to the bucket. Ferguson thought he'd just dish one off to the guy who's really leading the way right now for both sides.
Well, I tell you what, in games like this, most of the time a guy gets it, he's going to the bucket. So we'll blame it on the passing.
Down the bucket and up and off the glass. Nice fundamental move there by Holmes. And that's something that obviously John Thompson III loves to see, guys with the good fundamentals.
Now, their system is not a guard or post man heavy as far as sitting on the block, but if he can do that on a consistent basis, I'm pretty sure J3 will find a spot for him on one of those blocks next year at Georgetown.
Shot up by Cook off the glass and good. He mentioned that, Junior, and the fact that really we saw that a little bit in the tournament game against NC State as the shot goes up and knocked down there by Savage, but kind of having some of those guards who got matchups down the post against smaller guys for NC State, but really didn't know what to do with it. Guys at 6'7", 6'8", more so, you know, that's going to be big in that offense where they have to give some things up to guard it, maybe some untraditional skills that may help you out at Georgetown.
Right. Well, you know, I'm an ACC guy, so I picked NC State to beat Georgetown, sadly to say. But the bottom line is that when you start talking about the college game, if you can get a few guys that can play inside, outside, Mr. Bolden is right up their alley of long, athletic, length. Those are the kind of things they're looking for. He's done a great job of recruiting those kind of players. But now what you need to have is a couple of guys that can really, really put it down and score this basketball. He lost a couple of seniors in Jason Clark and Henry Sims. in this area. I'm excited to see what he's going to be able to do next year for Georgetown and over the next couple of years with a few of the other guys they have coming back.
Yeah, they've really got a lot of players coming back. The top three guys are gone, but those guys coming back in some showtime there for Brandon Bolden. Once again, remember, the Elite Showcase Basketball Classic features many of the premier players in the nation. Visit us at www.esbcbasketball.com.
And I tell you what, outside of him having all his long hair, I like him as a player now.
Ball knocked around, and of course we see a guy next to me. I have no hair. Junior has short hair, so it all worked out. But 55-32 our score, and really the North, the team leading, and they've just taken. You don't really see this, I guess. You see it in All-Star games a little bit, but usually one team makes a run. You see the South team kind of coming back and getting this a little bit closer.
Well, the thing about the run is that they ran it for layups and dunks, and that kind of gives you that lead. It's not just about jump shots. You know, those things are. You can't really tell if your jump shot's going to go in and how nervous they are, but, you know, this North team has gotten a bunch of layups, a bunch of dunks, and when those things are going on, you can build a lead like this. But since they've got over their nerves, the South has made the game pretty even, but that first 10 to 7 minutes, you know, is pretty much costing this lead.
Yeah, again, 55 for the North and 32 for the South. We talked about it again here at the 2012 Elite Showcase Basketball Classic at Trinity University in Washington, D.C. And now the guy who's been the star so far, Molly Clox, gets his shot blocked. He'll take it back up, and a foul's going to be called. I believe this will go on Zach Elcano, and a strong move to the bucket by Clox gets him to the line. I'm actually going to say it's a non-shooting foul.
Now, what's exciting me the most about that play is that, you know, when you get to the next level, your shot's going to get blocked. And I think a lot of times what people don't realize as a big man myself, you're going to get your shot blocked. It's going to happen. It's part of basketball. But if you keep playing and you keep showing everybody there's still a lot of effort left in you, then that's when you get better as a player. You can't just leave it out there because the floor is full of other good players. That's the bottom line. You know, you're not going to just be the best guy on the floor at all times. You have to be the hardest working guy if you can.
Another outside shot missed. And again, the North really dominating the backboards right now. And Cox, nice move to get loose. And another one-handed throwdown.
He's making it look easy. We got to make sure that goal is 10 feet. That goal doesn't look 10 feet down there for Cox.
It looks more than 10 feet for me. I'm about a foot shorter than you are, so I don't know that rarefied air the guys like you dwell in.
Man, I thought when I went under there it was 10 feet, but he's making it look a lot shorter.
Long air ball at Holloway again, leading the break, really playing that point guard position here. He'll dish it off behind the back. Nice setup and not knocked down, but nice move there by Holloway, showing all his skills. And now the other way, another showtime attempt, but can't get it to go down as Johnson misses the dunk. And quickly the other way, another alley-oop attempt, not there. Washington pulls in the rebound. He'll turn around, hook shot, can't get it to go. Alcano with the rebound.
I'll tell you what. It really, at this time, I think the North is just playing harder, man. They're playing the whole game. They're just playing harder.
And that time, a little bit of inadvertent defense, I guess you could say, as Obina Aleka able to get that one to go down, and he gets fouled on the dunk attempt. You don't usually see that in an All-Star game.
Well, I think the ref is just, you know, trying to get catch his breath as well, you know. That was one of the soft love taps of all night. You know, it's kind of funny that he would call that. Mr. Aleka is undecided. He's not sure where he wants to go. A little bird explained it to me.
Yep. And we'll go ahead and get back to Junior's thought, but first we'll get down to Daniel Zimmet.
Joining me now here is Daquan Cook of the South team. Daquan, what made you want to go all the way out west to UNLV play out there?
Coach Rice and Coach Shoya, they just showed me how much they really wanted me in the type of situation that I'm going to. Oscar, he's leaving this year. He was a four-year starter, and so that just gives me time to come in and play from the start.
How difficult is it to play here with a bunch of guys that you've never been with before?
I mean, it's not that hard because I'm a facilitator. I'm a point guard, so I just get everybody involved in the game, so it's not that hard.
Well, good luck today and have some fun out there.
Thanks.
Back to you guys.
We have to, as the shot goes up, ask Daquan at some point, that big win they had against North Carolina this year, did that enter into the decision to say, hey, this is the place for me, this program really on the up and up?
Absolutely. I mean, UNLV, first of all, is in Las Vegas, so, I mean, they're – what happens in Vegas stays in Vegas, as we both know. For them to get a kid out of Baltimore just goes to show that they're a national recruiting class now, a national recruiting. And he's going to be helpful. If he goes out and gets an opportunity to really play and be successful out there, then you'll see UNLV coming in, flagshipping and coming in and taking some of the players from this area. So, you know, he's going to be one of those guys that, you know, that could really turn it around for that UNLV area. Because if you can get a couple of these Baltimore kids to make that commute,
yeah,
it's going to turn your program around.
You talk about Mr. Aleku who misses the second free throw. You said maybe some of the get an inside look of maybe where he's headed to?
Absolutely. His mentor, AAU coach, comes over here and says maybe Providence. He loves Rutgers. So, you know, you're talking about a Big East guy. So, I mean, those are the kind of things you really want. I'm pretty sure those are two of the better schools in the Big East. They're looking for players at both of those schools. I mean, Rutgers had a beginning of the year was pretty good and kind of fell off. Providence struggled pretty much all year and played hard. He'll fit right in with either one of those programs.
Yeah, you talk about Rutgers. They had the big win over Florida, a team that may end up going to the Final Four. We'll find out later on tonight. So, obviously, again, a kind of place where you see guys, they get that big win on TV. It has to help in recruiting.
It always helps when your teams are good or they do something that you're not expecting. And when you're in a recruiting class, the first thing the coach is going to say, hey, this could be you. This could be you helping us get over. We need a couple more players like yourself that will get us over the top, and we'll beat teams like this on a regular basis.
57-36, the black-clad North with the lead over the white-clad South team as the three-pointer goes up and some long-range accuracy from Frank Mason knocks another one down.
Mr. Mason showing us everything, inside, outside, assists. I tell you, this Townsend, man.
Getting themselves a nice player, also a nice player, Brandon Bolden. Another nice move to the bucket. And we've seen with Georgetown, they let their bigs make moves like that. He'll fit in perfectly.
I tell you what, if he's been watching Henry Sims play over these last couple of years, then he'll be a great player because Henry Sims has shown you that you can do a couple of things with this basketball outside of shooting it, passing it, distributing it. He's a leading assist guy on the Georgetown team. It's sad to see him go out the way they did, obviously losing a game in the NCAA tournament. But the bottom line is that the bigs are basketball IQ guys. And I'm just really pleased to see them get another kid that can play.
Yeah, and you talk about it, his skills, Bolden's that is, really fit that program so well. And really, if you're a guy who fancies himself as a guy who can do a lot, playing for JT3 is a perfect place to be.
He gives his kids the freedom to play within his system. They always call it the Princeton offense or whatever that may be, but the bottom line is that it just has Princeton fundamentals. And he just does a great job of letting guys play, do what they can do, and showing them, you know, just really how to be all-around basketball players. It's not about how many points you score all the time.
And a nice three-point bucket there by Melvin Johnson to end our half. The University of Miami product going ahead and getting one to go down, but they'll need a few more in the second half as the North squad leads 60-43 here at the end of the first half. And really, we've seen some very good performances. I think first and foremost have to mention Mo Ali Cox and Frank Mason for the North side. But first, we'll go ahead and talk about that later. First, we'll get it down to Daniel for another update.
I'm here with Coach Carter of the North team right now. Coach, you guys have a 17-point lead here at the half. What's the difference in the two teams here? They both have elite players on them.
I think one of the main differences is that we tell our guys just to relax, have fun, enjoy the game. This is an all-star game. Have fun. We lose. Our style is more run and gun. And so far, the team responded well to it.
What's it like to coach a bunch of guys that you've never coached together and that haven't played together?
Oh, it's fun. It's a good experience, and look forward to doing it again.
Well, thanks a lot, Coach, and have fun in the second half. Back to you.
Coach Cox doesn't seem excited about his 17-point lead.
not at all, though. I think there's still more work to be done with this 60-43 lead for the North. We talked a little bit about some of the guys who stood out. Obviously, you have to mention for the North side, Mo Ali Cox and Frank Mason. Mo's got 17 points, Mason with 14. Remember, and both those guys headed to the CAA, Ali Cox to VCU, and Mason to Towson. So some guys who may see each other on the court very soon at their respective schools.
You know what's funny about that? You're talking about a guard and a big guy for the most part. And those are cornerstones of your program a lot of time. Mason is doing a fantastic job of just laying the ball up, getting to the middle, pushing the ball up in transition and taking what the defense is giving you. And, of course, the big fellas finishing up under the basket, dunking everything around it, offensive rebounding, defensive rebounding. I'm pretty sure Shaka Smart knew exactly what he was doing when he got this kid. You can see it even in an all-star game that his motor never comes off. And I'm just really pleased to see him just playing through it because, really, it's just an all-star game. But a lot of times you can set your tone by the way you play and you're playing hard. And that's one of the main reasons why they have a 17-point lead. So this kid is just out there just playing hard.
Yeah, he's playing hard, getting good shots, also getting to the rim. I think that might be even a little bit of difference. You talked about it. Big men in all-star games really don't get a lot of opportunities. Almost you have to reach out and grab them. And to me, that means you got to run the court because the guards, they're going to give it up for that showtime pass. Maybe not for the shots, but, hey, if they get a chance to get you up for a nice-looking dunk, that benefits them and you.
Well, maybe he read the memo, because he's definitely doing exactly that. He's running the floor. He came in. It looks like he's in shape. And he's just finishing every play he gets an opportunity to get. I enjoy watching an undersized big man. I really wasn't an undersized big man all the time, but at 6'8", you know, playing against the North Carolinas and the Florida States and all those schools, Duke, you know, every now and then you'll run up across the Cherokee Park and 7-footers. And he's showing you that you can do it at 6'6" in the CAA. I think he's going to be a steal. He's going to be a fantastic player for soccer down there at BCU. I can already see it, because he has big hands. He doesn't mind giving the ball up, and he's just running the floor and just playing his role. So that translates. You know, you see a lot of guys who score a lot of points. The way this kid is playing, it translates to the next level.
Yeah, and obviously it translates with his system that he'll be seeing at BCU. Like I said, it's that system, and we kind of talked about it a little bit during the first half. And I like to almost compare it to the old, you know, Georgetown under John Thompson and Nolan Richardson under Arkansas at 40 minutes of hell, if you will, where basically you have to be in shape and ready to run the court if you're going to be a success, obviously from the fact that, you know, you're playing the defense, but there's the offensive turnovers and leads to points that you have a chance to get if you're in shape and ready to go ahead and play that
and
way.
And I tell you what, it's an intimidation factor. I mean, everybody knows you're going to play a BCU or one of those Arkansas teams, which, by the way, I had an opportunity to play against. And it's not fun. For my Elite Eight run, we played Arkansas to go to the Final Four. And at that point in time, you know, everybody knows what the other team is going to do. But the bottom line is that you have to be ready to play a team like that. And I think this kid is showing you that, listen, no matter when I show up, when I put my tennis shoes on, I'm ready to play.
Most definitely. We've seen that so far today out of Cox. On the other side of things, the South team led in points by three players. Daquan Cook, we talked to her from him, headed to UNLV. Also, Brandon Bolden, the Georgetown product, or the guy who's going to Georgetown, that is, and Melvin Johnson, headed to the University of Miami. And I guess really stand out in these two of those three guys, to me at least, Cook a little bit with his outside shooting, his playmaking, and then Bolden, who kind of showed off a lot of different things that he can do. Your thoughts on those two?
Absolutely. I mean, you look at him, I mean, the score was getting out of control, and you could tell it. Daquan just actually took over, showed he, okay, it's time for me to start scoring now. And that's going to be the situation he's going to be in at UNLV, being able to feel what type of game you're going to be playing in and what you need to do as a point guard. He's already told you in a small interview that they lost their senior point guard. He has an opportunity to play right away. He's going to give them the best, you know, best chance as a freshman. And you can already tell he's a very basketball IQ guy, so to speak. You can see that he's giving the ball up. He's facilitating. He doesn't mind showing you that he can play both in scoring and rebounding and throwing the ball up. So I'm really pleased with what he's doing. Mr. Bolden is giving you a little bit of everything.
Yeah.
You know, he's a buffet right now, a food translation. He's rebounding. He's scoring from outside, inside, and defending pretty well. The bottom line is if he can get a couple more of his kids to play, they'll make this a game.
Yeah. And you look at this, and I really think, and this is something I'd love to ask you, since obviously you were there at an ACC school at the time, maybe the best conference in America. You look at it, and we're starting to see more good basketball conferences, where you look at the CAA, where you've got a BCU and a George Mason that have national names from their Final Four runs. Out west, the Mountain West, we talked about where Mr. Cook's headed. You got UNLV, you've got San Diego State out there, you've got some of the big-time programs, Colorado State starting to come on. You know, does that, as a college player, maybe make it a little bit easier for you or tougher in the sense you can say, well, obviously I can go to this big-time school everyone knows about, or maybe go to a place where maybe it's a little bit lower, but hey, I still get that exposure and I get a chance maybe to make my name easier, quicker, or maybe I can get in that starting lineup faster.
Absolutely. I mean, I'm glad you asked that question. There are a lot of different ways to answer it, but I mean, obviously you're talking about when you're at those smaller schools, they don't leave those schools earlier. I mean, that's just the bottom line. I mean, Kentucky, my wife and I were joking about Kentucky senior night is going to be never going to happen, really. Yeah. You don't think it's ever going to happen at Kentucky to have a senior night. But you look at some of these other schools, and if you watch some of these interviews from some of these other coaches about being able to coach a kid for 4 years, and how they've turned out, how they've grown as players and stuff like that. Those smaller schools are where that's happening at. It's not going to happen at Carolina. I mean, to be honest, it's not going to happen at Duke. It's not going to happen at these bigger schools. So you're going to get a kid a lot of opportunities to play. But for me, you have transfers into these smaller schools as well, because they've outpointed their coverage, so to speak, as far as going to these bigger schools and not being able to translate, like we talked about earlier with Cox. His skills will translate to BCU. If he would have chosen a Virginia Tech or Syracuse at his size, he may not have had an opportunity to play right away, and he would have been recruited over which people don't realize that once they recruit you, some of these national powerhouses they're still out on the road, so to speak. They don't just leave your house and go home, you know. And it's just one of those things that you have to always pay attention to when you're being recruited by some of these bigger schools, how they play when you get there. Also, are they throwing the ball to your position? When I was being recruited by Coach Jones, they threw the ball to Kenny Turner. He was a power forward before I got there. So I'm watching a guy catch the ball, score the ball, et cetera. And I was just going to be an extension of him. And I just turned it. And then after I left, Norman Nolan and then Travis Watson, et cetera. So.
Let's go ahead and get an update from Daniel Dennis.
I'm here right now with the founder of the Elite Showcase Basketball Classic, Thomas Gadsden. Thomas, can you tell us what you guys are all about, what you're trying to do here today?
Yeah, about 3 years ago, we started this program. And our goal is to bring the ESBC to national prominence, actually international prominence. So each year, we've actually went after certain players, certain type of players, players that have national recognition and bring them to this specific game. And really not focus on a geographical type of showcase game, but as I said before, international. So that's where we're going with this dream. Again, started off about 3 years ago with the idea of say, hey, let's bring a showcase game, a high quality showcase game, a little bit different flavor to what we're doing, and that's where we're at right now.
What does it take to pull off an event like this?
A lot. There's a lot of back-end stuff that goes on. A lot of people say they don't see me until like at the 99th hour, but I'm constantly, you know, making stuff happen. If it's from a kid that's not, his shoe size is wrong, we try to make that happen. I mean, we really do a great job. I have a terrific staff with the Elite Showcase Basketball Classic. Everybody from Michael Carter, who's our director of marketing, to Bernardo Omar, who's our director of operations. These guys put in a lot of labor to make this happen. So it's not myself, it's the other people around that makes it go.
What's in store in the future for you guys? What can we expect?
Well, you know, next year we're actually looking to take this to the next level. We're actually looking at maybe having an international game such as like this, the ESBC international game. We're actually looking at do more on the girls' side as well. We want to bring more girls of the top 100 class to this particular game. So we're actually looking at doing a lot. And with the help of you guys, you know, we're actually taking this game and putting it out to folks that are not physically here, but can actually look at the game on the different mediums via the internet.
Well, thanks a lot for joining me, and congratulations on another successful event.
Thank you.
Back to you guys.
And we talked about it there with Mr. Gadsden. We're kind of talking as Daniel was doing the update, that the fact that they've really got some things going when it comes to this event. It's in D.C., which is always a good place to come. It's not like, no disrespect to other places, but, you know, D.C. is one of the best cities in America, and be able to come in here and kind of be wine and dine and treated like a big-time player, that has to be appealing to these kids. And they'll go back and maybe tell some of their buddies on the AAU circuit or in college, hey, this is a good place to go to.
Listen, I tell you what, Thomas Gadsden is a close friend of mine. I know him behind the scenes. He's done a fantastic job promoting this game. And I'm just proud, and I know you are, just being a part of it. Hopefully this thing goes out to be a successful situation. But I can't imagine him not turning this game into exactly what he wants it to be in. This is a fantastic atmosphere. The D.C. area is one of the best areas you could possibly have as far as basketball goes. Being a North Carolina kid, to see, being up here for a few years, to see how many players come from here and see how many things are going on. It's really nice to see this. And Mr. Thomas has done a great job of putting it all together.
And I want to remind you that the Elite Showcase Basketball Classic features many of the premier players in the nation. Visit us at www.esbcbasketball.com. Shot up from the outside and good, knocking it down. Aaron Park with the first bucket for the north side for a three-pointer, and the lead back out 63-45 for the north side. Maybe Cook for the three. That one missed, knocked around, volleyballed around. You have to see the athletic ability. Guys can't hold on to it, but they can get up after that bucket. Shot up, and that one will go down for Dunbar, so two for him.
Here you go. Here's an opportunity now for them to get back into the game. I mean, these are some of the shots that's going to give us the chance to get back into the game. I mean, you really want a closer game. If you're going to get an all-star game, you can see some of the competition. But now, I guess, a little locker room time, a little coaching, get the kids an opportunity to rest a little bit and just see what they can do.
Up and no good. That one altered by Elcano. And now a break the other way for the South. and vote with some showtime for Brandon Bolden and a timeout, another quick timeout, but he's now got 10 as the lead cut down 63-49 for the North's advantage with just about 90 seconds gone here in the second half. So you mentioned it, the run being cut down by the South, and we see it in the NBA All-Star game all the time. You'll see one team up by 25 at one point, you turn around, go get some coffee, you come back. It's a five-point game. It just seems to happen in these games.
Right. Well, you don't want to be critical, obviously, of kids in the All-Star game. But the bottom line is when you start taking those kind of shots, I mean, you have the last three or four shots. One went in. They've all been a little erratic. You've given the South the opportunity to run down, dunk the ball, layups, transition. Maybe it's just this end of the floor. This end of the floor seems to be the layup and dunk end of the floor. Hopefully, the North will calm down. It was a great timeout. It showed you some of the coaches you have over here as far as being good coaches. Just to sit down and just say, listen, calm down, relax. You're up 13, 14 points. Just get back to what we were doing. Give us an opportunity to still win this basketball game, because nothing makes you feel better, even in these kind of games, outside of winning. You still want to say, I won the game.
Yep. It's always good. These guys are competitors. They want that W at the end of the night, and that one going to go off the leg of Frank Mason. So ball back over to the South with another chance to cut into the lead.
A little bit of over-dribbling, which caused that turnover. I tell you what, the South has some length. And you have to be careful a lot of times.
Shot put back up and can't get it to go down as Aleka had a chance for two. He'll go to the line and get him that way as opposed to for the three-point play.
Now, I ask you, Jason, do you think that they changed jerseys? Because it seems like this white team is playing hard, like the North team played earlier. It seems like they changed ends. This end down here seems to be the hard playing end, the offensive rebounding end, the layup end.
Mr. Aleka out of Florida Christian Institute. He's undecided on where he'll be headed to school. Remember, The Rock is the official basketball, the Elite Showcase Basketball Classic.
Really can't wait to see how he turns out and what school he decides to go to. A dynamic power forwards type, really skilled. You know, if he can get the right coaching at whatever school he decides to go to, you might have a chance to see him playing even on a higher level than what he's now. Not just college, but a pro level. Very talented, very skilled.
And remember, you can purchase a copy of this broadcast at www.synthesismp.com.
Of course they want to pay to listen to us. Wouldn't that be a nice scenario, obviously?
I don't know. I think they want to see the elite players out here. And the one going to the free throw line right now, that's Marshall Wood. Just got his first bucket of the game a couple minutes ago. He's headed to Virginia Tech from the Rustburg area, I believe, down a little bit past Lynchburg.
Well, that Virginia Tech thing still bothers me a little bit, as you know, being a Virginia guy. But, you know, Seth Greenberg also does a great job of nationally recruiting, but staying home and getting players. I'm pretty sure if he gets an opportunity to go down there and play for this guy, they're hungry down at Virginia Tech for a winner. They missed the NCAA tournament this year, and they have a bunch of young kids that can play down there. He's just fitting right in with another athletic kid, a couple of athletic players down there. They had a few injuries last year that really slowed them at the end of the year, but I'm thinking that Virginia Tech is going to be right 20-win season next year.
It'll be nice. The Hokies obviously was a great football program. The basketball program was coming up but had the tough year this year as the rebound off the miss put in by Washington. Can't get the hook to go down, and quick the other way goes the South. Cook with a nice dish and a flush there by Aleka.
Mr. Cook doing what Mr. Cook does, facilitating. The Thomas and Mack Center is going to be fantastic. It's going to be exciting. If he can get up and down the floor and get some other athletes with him, I can't wait to see what they do down there at UNLV.
Talk about the look. What a fantastic find there to find a Laker for the dunk. And always good to have guys like this that can finish when you get them the ball.
This could help him. This could help Mr. Cook undecided. You can get a guy like that to finish for you in these All-Star games. You might get a guy like this to finish for you at UNLV. He's still undecided.
No indecision for Mr. Washington as he's able to go ahead and knock that one down. He's headed to from Hargrove Military Academy, headed to Wake Forest to play in the ACC. And now we've seen one of our few fouls in the game. That'll send Aleka to the line. 65-63 our score. The black-clad North team on top of the white-clad South. 16-56 left to go in our second half.
There's just so much more intensity to this second half than there was in the first half. And now you can see the guys now are tuning in, focusing in, trying to win. You can tell these coaches went in and got kind of lit a fire under each one of them. just playing and being competitive.
An interesting shot we just saw there where it's Tillman Dunbar and Patrick Holloway, teammates at Paul VI, playing on different sides as we have a chance. Ball knocked around and will be chased down in time. It will be, and Holloway with the hustle, but can't get it to go.
That's what I'm talking about. That's the kind of hustle you want to see. You know, even though it's an All-Star game, you can still be your true self by playing through it and hustling. Another block.
Washington showing off those low post skills on the defensive end, but a steal by Cook, and he has a 3-on-2 break. What will he do? He dishes it back up and off the glass, no good. And volleyballed around, finally tracked down in the corner, and the three-pointer up and off the iron, no good. Again, shot now, and up, and Aleko again with a bucket from close range.
The South is playing harder now. You know, they cut into this lead. They're doing a great job of offensive rebound and getting back. A couple of steals from, it looks like Mr. Cook is actually playing both ends of the floor. You can tell he's putting his handprint on this game already. You can see it. He's starting to push some of his own players, push some of his kids, some of his teammates. It's nice to always see that leadership.
And he even mentioned it. Cook said that he's a facilitator. That's his thing. It's not as much to score with him. He's a guy who loves to give that good pass. And we've seen it a couple times, especially on that dunk with Obinna Olaika.
I'll tell you what happens a lot of times. When you can find a point guard, and it's happening now with Kendall Marshall, or maybe a Teague if you're watching the NCAA tournament, those kids are, you make the big men run faster knowing they're going to get the ball. And that's what you really want. Mr. Cook is doing exactly what he said he was doing on his interview. He's going to facilitate this team and get them up and down the floor. And of course, Olaika and Bolden, those guys are just finishing these plays up under the basket, got them back in the game.
And you make a great point there. You talk about North Carolina and really, really struggled last night without Kendall Marshall and, you know, Clark Kellogg and Marv Albert and Steve Kerr on the broadcast last night. But really, you made a point to say this team just cannot. The big guys here are struggling because Kendall Marshall's not there to get them the ball in good position.
It's kind of funny that you mentioned that we're talking about that. I mean, I've got an opportunity, obviously, to see North Carolina play over a few years. Kendall Marshall, Carolina's a Mercedes or a Bentley or a Phantom or whatever kind of car you want to use. Kendall Marshall's a steering wheel. Yep. I mean, it's just the bottom line. You know, they can put anybody at the wheel you want. It's not the same. He finds people when nobody else is looking. He understands how to get the ball to people on time. And you're talking about a 6'5 guard. I mean, it's a couple other things that he brings to the table that you just don't find. And he's been scoring a lot more lately. The game he got hurt, he had 18 points, 13 assists. That's the kind of team that's a national championship team. And if he can come back for them, they're still going to have a chance to win. And it's going to help me win my bracket.
Which is always a plus. Of course, if he does come back, he'll see this guy at the line, Andre Washington, headed to Wake Forest next year, able to go ahead and knock down the free throw. He'll look for one more. And really, he's scoring okay so far, but his defense has been phenomenal today.
I tell you what, if you, once again, we're talking about changing one end of the floor. If you can be a dominant player on one end of the floor and he can work on some of his skill set here on his offensive end, he'll be somebody you'll be able to look after, because they have a couple of players down there, Travis McKay, and they have a couple of guards that their name lose me now, but he's just one of those guys down there that's going to play hard. You see him playing hard the whole time. He's a defensive guy, and I can't wait to see him.
See what he can do for that Wake Forest team, but obviously that black jersey he's wearing right now, that same color going to fit in well. And now a little Curly Neal impersonation by Tillman Dunbar, goes down to the bottom, keeps the dribble, but then gets it taken away. Now back over Cook, dishes off Olaika with the flush.
I tell you what, there's going to be a talk in the locker room about coming to UNLV for Mr. Cook and Olaika. I can tell you that right now. I promise you that there's going to be some type of situation, because they're both local kids from the very beginning. I mean, and so you'll see.
No, Ali Cox has his shot blocked, but Olaika gets him on the arm, raises the hand, says he fouled him, so the VCU commit is going to go ahead and go to the line.
It seems like the North team just stopped playing. And they're just waiting on the South to make the game close, and they're going to keep finishing. But this is the way you get your game. You stop a run right here. You get on the free throw line, get yourself relaxed, and make a couple of free throws.
Mo Ali Cox knocks down that free throw. He's at a Middleburg Academy in Virginia, just down Route 50 from Dulles Airport, headed to VCU to play for Shaka Smart. And we've talked about it, only 6'5", but really has a skill set that fits what the Rams do well.
Plays a lot bigger than he is. Strong, long arms, very explosive, big-time rebounder.
A nice steal there. Some athleticism from Jamal Ferguson. He'll take it in, get the harm. They're going to say a push-off on Ferguson.
Now, this is the
Ferguson.
First offensive foul on the break you're going to get here in an All-Star game.
Yeah, it's interesting to see. We'll go ahead and check in with Daniel Zimmet once again.
I'm here with Coleman Johnson right now. Coleman, you got one of your teammates at Paula Six on your team. You're playing against one on the other team. What's that like? You guys got any wagers going on the side here?
I told Till before the game, we're going to win, plain and simple. The North's going to beat the South, so we're going out there and doing it right now. They're making a little run, but in the end, we'll come out on top.
What made you decide to go to Fairfield? What was the decision maker in the end?
Just the coach, the staff, and the team. When I went up there, it felt right, and I felt like the valid feel of it.
Well, have fun today, and good luck in the future. Back to you guys up there.
Thanks, Daniel. You mentioned it, Fairfield, a team that almost went to the NCAA tournament, lost their conference final to Loyola this year, and their team that's been there the last couple years, and maybe more importantly, has been in contention to get to the Big Dance.
I tell you what, if you can recruit kids like this who come from really good programs, Fairfield is going to be fine as far as making an NCAA tournament. They're from what we call a one seed conference.
Yep.
And, they've been doing it for a while down there. I can't imagine them not being back in the dance with these kind of kids playing on that team. He's a fantastic player.
Quickly,
plays hard.
Talk about that junior Cook up and no good. Rebound missed. Aleka's got it. He'll put it up. That one no good. The tap back doesn't fall. And now we're going to call goaltending on Elcano. So wipe the basket away, and it will not be a score for the South. Remember, the Rock is the official basketball of the Elite Showcase Basketball Classic.
Tell you what, the Rock doesn't want to go in for the South down there with all that hustle. They might want to change this official basketball part of it, but you can just tell that this South team is just playing a whole lot harder than they were in the first half.
And that time of three, knocked down by Melvin Johnson, quickly the other way. Actually, not Melvin Johnson, Coleman Johnson with that three.
Cook doing it again, putting on the burners. The meat on the way down the floor gets fouled.
So Cook will go ahead and go to the line. His team trails by 12, 72-60. The North leads now 72-61. Remember, the North in the black jerseys, the South in the white jerseys.
I tell you what, a lot of times when you do these games that nobody really thinks about is that some of these kids are coming from losing programs. We always talk about Paul the Sixth and some of these winning programs. You can tell in a game like this when you're down 19 points and all this other stuff, you can tell that this Cook kid is coming from a winning organization, a coaching staff that says you're always in the game. And that's the kind of thing that that translates also to college, a winning personality, a winning atmosphere, a winning tone, because you're going to be down. There's not going to be one college you can go to or sign with that hasn't been blown out or down 10, 15 points and had a chance to lose the game. But the coach, the players gave themselves an opportunity to stay in it and stay positive and gave themselves a chance to win the game.
Shot up and a nice strong move there by Aleka. He's really come on in the second half, and now the lead down to 8, 72-64 for the North.
Mr. Aleka has come alive for him down up under this hole. He's offensive rebounding. He's finishing up under the basket. You can see some of the strong skill sets that all these schools are recruiting for him.
Shot inside the arc, no good. Rebound to Aleka. He'll start the break. Numbers, the three is up, no good. Rebound knocked around, put up and in, and Tillman Dunbar kind of sneaks in and gets that bucket.
Four white jerseys under there waiting for the offensive rebound. This will be a good time for a black to get a timeout.
Holloway, Harry, he'll almost throw it away. Now finally gets down to Washington on the baseline. He'll slow it down a little bit, looking to get it back to the outside. And in the corner, three for Stoskis, and knocks it down.
Great pass, great shot.
Stoskis, a sharpshooter headed to Michigan. Really haven't seen him do it. That's his first bucket of the game.
Well, I tell you what, he can get wide open like that a couple more times. He'll make a few more.
Now shot off the back iron, no good by Bolden. 75-66, the North leads, and Stoskis going to take it to the bucket and slam it and count it and give him the foul.
The three the old-fashioned way. Three-pointed in a three-day old-fashioned way. I love to see it.
When you talk about it, he's a guy who's seen as a shooter from north of the border from Ontario, Canada. 6'6", though, a guy that size can do some things in the post.
I tell you what, and also, when you finally see one go in, it could change the whole way you're playing, especially with a guy who's known as a shooter. Now he made his first one, got a great pass, made his first one. Now he comes back, does something athletic, dunks and one. This could be the change of the game right here that the North is waiting on right now.
And I tell you what, it was good to see. You talked about guys really stepping up to maybe the conditions of the game. Duskus struggling out there, missing shots. He hits the three and almost a frustration. You know what? I'm going to dunk and show these guys I can play. And, boy, he threw one down right there.
That's also part of these All-Star games. A lot of times with the unknowns part of the game, guys aren't as highly touted or whatever. You can always come in there with a little chip on your shoulder. And now he's playing in late minutes, 12 minutes to go in the game. Six straight points for him. Big momentum change. The South was coming back, playing very well. And now he scores 6 points in a row. Always helps when you can bring somebody off the bench like that who can really shoot it.
It's definitely 78-68. The Norse lead back to 12 with 12:42 and rolling here from Trinity University, the 2012 Elite Showcase Basketball Classic.
Say, well, he gets some open shots in Michigan.
He will. That's the way John Beilein does. And a nice open shot there for Charles Taylor, who takes it right in with the finger roll. Now 4-3 from the outside. That one good. Aaron Park showing off some range and in the face.
Hand down, man down, hand up, so what?
And now another three the other way. That's going to miss everything. Is a little bit overzealous by Taylor trying to knock that one down, but couldn't get it to go.
Did you feel the breeze in the gym when he shot it? Did you feel that? I could feel a little bit of it. Maybe that's what it was.
Something happened. You know. Jeremy Huber, Junior Burrow here with you for the Elite Showcase Basketball Classic. And really seeing some good basketball here in the second half. Maybe a little bit of kind of tightening when it comes to playing more of the style you would see with these guys' regular teams and their regular coaches.
I tell you what also happens. When the game gets closer, then you can see the lack of chemistry going on. So that's when you need a leader or a point guard and a cook or one of those guys or a Mason who's actually playing and understands how to get people in place and show. Those kind of things really do help in All-Star games, like just to finish out a game in the right way. If you can keep this game close, you'll be able to see those guards be able to put people in place.
Nice dunk for Kyle Thomas. He's out of Baltimore, Maryland, undecided. Another one of those guys trying to figure out where he's going to end up spending his college years. Now pull-up jumper. That one back iron. No roll, but Ali Cox gets it. He will dunk it. Cleared out space, and O'Connor able to throw it down.
The big fella. Clearing out space. They may have moved that goal down, too, on this end, too. It looks like he just makes these goals look really short.
He talked about it, the fact that some of these guys can play undersized, but you can make up for it. And Cox got a big, strong body, able to kind of get some leverage on those bigger players. And now alley-oop, showtime. Can't get it to go, though, as Savage was looking for the big dunk, and that'll set up some numbers the other way. And an alley-oop attempt here. That one off the rim, no good.
I tell you what.
Back the other way, and this time a little easier, the layup for Mason.
The South is taking a couple of shots that have changed momentum. Couple of long threes. Now you're giving the North the opportunity to get back out of the lead.
Now with it, remember the Elite Showcase Basketball Classic features many of the premier players in the nation. Visit us at www.esbcbasketball.com. Acrobatic shot, can't get it to fall, but that'll send Dunbar to the line.
I tell you what, that full transition game can really show you how fatigued some of the guys are at times. But I tell you what, this has been a really well-played game up to this point. You know, obviously a couple of misses here, a couple of shots going here for these other teams, North or South. But the bottom line is that it's really been a well-played game.
Shot up from the free throw line by Dunbar, can't get it to go. He could be headed to Navy. He's out of Paul VI, the top team in the Washington, D.C. area, and a guy who really going to get some playing time, you think, quickly for Navy under Ed DeCellis, the former coach at Penn State. He's moved on to Navy. They really struggled this year, but Dunbar, a guy I would think can come in really early on and help them out.
I tell you what, Coach DeCellis, Navy plays a tough schedule as well. I don't know if people realize. I mean, the last few years, they've had one of the toughest schedules in the country. They've gone all over the country, obviously playing some of the bigger schools and stuff like that. So he's going to have an opportunity to play against some of the best competition, best guards in the country right away. And I think that's what you want.
Cox was looking for the alley-oop, couldn't get it. And right now we'll get an update from Daniel Zimmet.
I'm here with Melvin Johnson right now, going to the University of Miami next year. What made you choose Miami? What was the determining factor for you?
I had a great relationship with the coaching staff and the team and everything. I just felt real comfortable.
You're making a transition into the ACC. What do you think that's going to be like for you?
I think it's going to be rough. I think I need to do a lot of work, a lot of tuning in just to get stronger and everything.
Well, good luck in the future and have fun out there today.
All right, thank you.
Back to you.
Thanks, Daniel. And Melvin, maybe being he's having a maybe more grounded than some other players said, hey, I'm not sure. I got to do some things before I'm ready for the ACC.
Well, Melvin should get a mulligan. I mean, his visit to Miami, I mean, that's not really something you should be able to use in your interview. Somebody visiting Miami, of course your visit to Miami went well. I mean, South Beach, come on now.
It is definitely a place to be, and with Jim Larranega being down there, that's got to be a good combo of a coach who's done some good things, but also a wonderful place to go to school.
Coach Larranega and Miami, South Beach, that's a very nice. I'm thinking about taking a visit down to him just to see him play in the game. I can't wait. Somebody wants to get us down there. Maybe we can do a game down in South Beach. That would really help. Wouldn't that be nice?
I wouldn't be opposed to it. You know. Remember, you can purchase a copy of this broadcast at www.synthesismp.com.
Bring out the suntan lotion. That'd be nice. Strictly in a professional scenario, obviously. I mean, you know.
Who knows? Maybe we can get you down doing some of the ACC games down there.
Yeah, you know, maybe get my feet out of some sandals out there in the sand. You can do a lot of things with these computers nowadays. You don't have to actually be at the game. You can, you know, so.
We'll get you your own feet and get your toes in the sand doing the game. That's
nice,
a good
speed,
idea.
Nice feet, a couple of pina coladas.
Now the violation going to be called on Mason. He missed the two free throws there and didn't look too good. Maybe a little something he can improve in his game.
You know, there's always improvement, you know. Towns are going to need those free throws to go in, though. We haven't talked about enough about this two-year losing streak, basically. And he's going to be, I tell you what, I wouldn't be surprised if he changes that immediately for Townsend as far as his ability, because you can see it. Even every time he touches the ball, his ability to play.
The alley-oop attempt for Ali Cox, can't get it, tries to volleyball it around, but ends up to a break for the South squad. Dish down low, thunder dunk for Bolden. Two-handed flush. Gotta love that.
Bolden doesn't have any problems finishing with the dunk, though. I really love to see the big guys running the floor and playing.
Well, knocked around again, and that dish just not there. Looking to find Washington down low. Gives the my bad tap to the chest.
Gotta hold on to it, big fella. He's not trying to, you know, when you look in a game like this, when guards are playing back and forth against other competitive guards, if you're a big guy and you have a couple opportunities, you need to catch the ball. Now, he's not going to keep passing the ball to you if you're going to take away from his shot attempts.
Again, 89-80 is our score. The North with the lead on the South squad. As the South clad in white, the North squad clad in black, seen some very good plays by all sorts of players, as you would expect in a game like this. Bolden with it on the baseline. Turnaround jumper. That went off the iron. No good. Tapped around. Brought back in. Aleka with it. He'll get it off and the South will refresh. And now a three-point attempt from the wing. That one doesn't go.
Great pass. Great shot.
Two good passes. Up and under. No good. Stops just can't get the rebound. And now quickly the other way. Fast and furious action here at Trinity. Nice dish. Can they finish? They will. And the foul.
Great finish on this end. Shows that, like I said before, the South is actually one of those teams. But they keep playing, they have Cook on the floor. Everybody's making the extra pass and put them back in this game. It seemed like it was going to get out of the loss, taking it out of play. But now, it's only down 7 with the free throw attempt. Now you're looking at a good game. 7 minutes to go in the game. Hopefully it gets closer.
Yeah, that 20-something point lead down to 7. Can't convert the free throw, though, so it'll stay there. North leading 89-82 with 7:43 left to go. The shot up and no good, and now the South gets a chance to go ahead and cut even farther into that lead. Alley-oop attempt, no good, and it will be not saved. And I tell you one thing, Junior, these two squads definitely have to work on their alley-oops a little
Absolutely.
Bit.
Absolutely. It doesn't seem like they want to be the fish. It seems like he's throwing it to the top. Some of these guys need to maybe do a couple of calisthenics, some toe raises, or maybe these guys should just throw them a regular chest pass, but I guess it's for the fans, a little excitement. You know, what are you going to say? All-star game.
That's the one thing. This is the game where you can do that and maybe not be running stadium steps the next day if you mess it up.
I know some of these coaches. I'll tell you right now, Coach Jones would not like all these alley-oops going awry.
Of course, the coach at American University, who Junior played for at the University of Virginia. And obviously that program not doing so bad. Playing in the Patriot League, a very tough league when it comes to that kind of low major league. When you talk about Lehigh, that's all they were able to do. Those guys can play. T.J. McCallum first and foremost.
Even if you look at Lehigh and with their success and obviously beating Duke, Bucknell was very good this year. Obviously a fan of American got an opportunity to see him. Those three schools are competing with any schools in the country on a night-in, night-out basis. They have an opportunity to play because they're coached well. And these kids are going out there and playing hard, and it doesn't matter, you know, where you're going to school at. These coaches at those schools have had an opportunity to show you. And listen, if you just play hard and play the right way, we'll have a chance to stay in the game.
You talked about Bucknell. They were able to go ahead and get wins in the tournament, I believe, 2 years in a row, a couple years back. American came very close to knocking off a Scotty Reynolds-led Villanova team a few years back. So, really, you talk about those three schools, kind of like class of the Patriot League, but teams that can get in the tournament and do some damage when they're there. And a guy who can do some damage, Mo Ali Cox, nice feed to him, and he finished it.
Another finish for the big fella. But you look, obviously, at Bucknell, I mean, now the new rules with NIT, that the winner of your conference, regular season conference, gets an automatic bid to the NIT. And Bucknell, if I'm not mistaken, went out to Arizona and got a win.
Yes, they did. So
they obviously went to the Pac-10 and also got a win. So it continues to show you that the Patriot League has talent outside of just Lehigh going to beat Duke. But that's a big win for the Patriot League to even go out and get a win at the NIT at Arizona.
Yeah, most definitely, especially when you think about, obviously, Arizona a bit down this year. But, hey, there's still Arizona. That's a good, nice cult to put on your wall.
At Arizona with two or three pros on their team, to go out there and get a win, you know, saying something about what kind of talent you have around the Patriot League.
Naquan Cook at the line, hits his second. Remember, he's headed off to UNLV, the 6'1 point guard. And we'll go ahead and have a timeout. Here is our score, the North 93, the South 84, with 6:41 left to go in the second half. And, you know, you called it. Kind of these teams, one team just kind of get back into this game. That's what we've seen, a mix of, I think, some lackadaisical play, but also, I think, some more intensity kind of bubbling up from the South squad.
Where you can tell some of these coaches have obviously figured out who's playing well together. That's what one of the things that goes really well with this kind of thing. You see some of the great coaches here, the good coaching staff, and they've been able to see who plays well together, who's not. And now you have the game that's going to be close. It's going to come down to a couple of plays here and there that you can get the South back in the game, even closer, or the North pulling away from it.
Still plenty of time left to go in this game. Want to remind you once again, the Elite Showcase Basketball Classic features many of the premier players in the nation. Visit us at www.esbcbasketball.com. Also, want to let you know that The Rock is the official basketball of the Elite Showcase Basketball Classic. And if you want to see another broadcast of this game, have one for your own, you can go ahead and purchase a copy of this game at www.synthesismp.com. That's www.synthesismp.com to get the phenomenal analysis of Junior Burrow.
No, absolutely. That's what I need. Guru Nation, I like to call myself nowadays, every now and then. You need to be informed about something basketball or I'm here for you.
Are you on Twitter?
Sometimes. I'm tweeting a little bit.
All right.
I think my response and my graphic, you know, my ability, my grammar's off a little bit on the Twitter stuff. So
that's the one good thing, though. With Twitter, you can kind of get away with that.
Well, you know what? I try to sound as professional as I can, but
yes.
I need more characters. I'm just going to throw it out there. I need a couple more characters.
Well, I tell you what, that's an interesting thing you talk about. You know, now you're seeing even the high school guys tweeting, which I always think is kind of is a problem because I know what I was like at 17, 18 years old. There's a lot of things I would say that shouldn't have gone out for public consumption.
I tell you what, it is kind of funny, and even when I first heard the great Herm Edwards say it, don't press send.
That's right.
It's one of the funniest lines I've ever had, and I tell you what, it doesn't mean any more than now. You cannot press send. And I find myself not even wanting to press send when I do it, but what can I do? I'm an old grumpy guy.
Sometimes you do it. Jamal Ferguson able to get that one to go down. He's got eight. The Marquette soon to be Eagle as he goes ahead and gets this, extends the lead out 95-84. The North on top now with 6:11 to go.
I tell you what, Jay, you know, you can tell when you have a really good All-Star game is when you start calling out some of these names and where these kids are going, and you can't tell when you're watching the game where a kid is going to school at, because that's what it's come down to nowadays, is that this kid is going to Michigan, Marquette, et cetera. But you can't tell me where the Townsend kid is. You can't tell me where the Mason kid is. These guys are all really good basketball players. They've chosen to go to different schools, wherever it may be, because of coaching staff, chemistry, et cetera. And that's when you know you have a good All-Star game. This is another applaud out to Coach Thomas Gatsby as far as putting a good team together, two good teams together.
Most definitely. Cook able to knock down that shot. We mentioned Ferguson. He's going to Marquette. He seems to fit their style, too. A little bit undersized, but guys that can really get up and down the court and play good, tough defense.
The best compliment I've heard about a Marquette coach, their coach basketball team, is they play like their head's on fire. And if you watched them play through this tournament and had an opportunity to watch this group of guys play, that's exactly how they play. They play like every point, possession, rebound, everything counts.
And a long-range alley attempt on that one. And all Patrick Holloway can do is give the sheepish grin of that one wasn't what it was supposed to be. Definitely, I think Molly Cox would have had to be about 2 feet taller to bring that one in.
Well, he's dunked so many tonight. Maybe you think he can touch the top of the backboard.
Bolden up off and gets it to drop the friendly roll, and he has a chance to cut the lead down to 7 points.
Now, as a big man, to see a left-handed guy go back over his right shoulder is very rare. You know, to see a guy being able to go both ways. Great footwork, pump fake, nice shot. I tell you what, J3, he obviously knows what he's doing. Yep. But he'll be able to do something with this kid here on that block. Even though he's a small frame guy, you can tell he doesn't have a problem with contact. He's going to be pretty good down there.
Shot up and missed, and Alcano with it, and he can't get it to go, but it'll be Bolden coming back to get his miss eventually and get it to go down.
You can't teach effort. You just automatically have to have it. Mr. Bolden does.
He does, most definitely. 95-89 the score, so the North just with a 6-point lead. Molly Cox trying to change that, lose it, thought he was going to go ahead and travel, tried to dish it off to Stauskas, goes off of him out of bounds, so now the South has a chance to cut it even farther down.
Now see, as a coach, you would go to the big fella and say, keep doing what you do. You're a finisher, you're not a passer. Finish the play, shoot the ball, dunk the ball, whatever you can, get fouled. Don't change your game this late in the game.
Bolden turn around in the lane. That one barely draws iron, and then Cox with it. He'll dish it off. The North looking to go, and a foul will be called there as Savage made the nice move to the bucket, and it'll be giving up the foul. Bolden, you mentioned Bolden on the block. That's one of the parts, really, of the Georgetown offense. It really isn't there. They have the big men will sometime post up, but you don't really see those wings do it. This, maybe since Jeff Green, the only one they've had, and I think it maybe coincidentally, they went to the Final Four when he was there. Maybe Bolden, the guy that can eventually do that.
Right. I think, you know, what happens, obviously, when you're talking about a lottery pick in Jeff Green, just being able to facilitate the offense from down there. He wasn't just a scorer. He passed the ball. And it really does change the way you have to defend, because the hardest position to defend is a wing position. And you have a wing guy that's being posted up. He's also, he was 6'9". Just being able to do a bunch of other things, score the ball on a consistent basis. That was a possession team that played on that Final Four team. He's looking for that. This kid could be him.
Most definitely, as the shot goes down, and we will go ahead and get ourselves another update from Daniel Zimmet.
I'm standing here right now with Jamal Ferguson. Jamal, you're going to Marquette next year. What made you make that decision?
I like their facility. I like the way they play. I believe I can become a better player than I am now there. And I really like their coaching style. They really look to push their players real high to become strong men when they get older. So I really look forward to playing there.
How much fun was it to play out here with these guys today?
It was real fun. I thank God for having the opportunity to even play in a game like this, a little all-star game. I thank God for that.
Well, good luck in the future and congratulations. Back to you guys.
Thank you, Daniel. And Zach Elcano gets his first bucket of the game and got some really good position on the low block there.
I tell you what, finally a big man making a big man move. It's been a while.
Now he makes another big man move. He's able to go ahead and block that shot.
Just nice to see him. It seems like he's moving a whole lot better as he's gotten older. I've known him since he was about 14 years old. And just to see him moving up and down the floor really does show he's been coached well. He's going to have an opportunity to play at American, which is what you really want as a player, to get an opportunity to play. And he'll have his days where Coach Jones will be in his shorts as well.
Got at the buzzer, a three by Savage. What a shot to knock that one down. Makes it 99-91.
On his way to George Washington. They're rebuilding. They're turning that program around over there. Can't wait to see what's going on there. Mr. Cook right back at him.
Cook with the deuce, and it's now 99-94. And he'll go ahead and the North, which you don't usually see, going ahead and taking some time on this shot clock. Interesting, kind of actually some strategy coming from Coach Willard of the North squad.
You know, it's funny that you do this. Most of these games are guard dominated, and it's always nice to see some type of change as far as, you know, running some shot clock, time and score, what have you. Splash. I guess I'll leave it at that.
Aaron Parks with the three.
That's one of those. No. Great shot.
Plenty of those in your career. I'm sure you've seen one of those guards putting them up late, but that shot will go out of bounds. It'll stay, though, with the South squad. But yeah, that one you thought it didn't really wasn't the shot you want after running that much time. But hey, if it goes down, it's always a good shot,
it's
right?
It's always a great shot if it goes down. I'll keep using Coach Jones. Most of the time I heard that it was coming from my shot selection. So I won't throw anybody else under the bus. I heard it more with me.
But you hit far more than you missed back there, I know.
Oh.
Those good years. Now one-on-one, and they'll pull up for the three, and hit that one, too. Clay Mason showing off the long-range dagger.
There's back-to-back no great shot attempts for the North team.
Showing off some range, obviously, in the CAA. That's a big shot. It's missed. And now quickly the other way, two-on-one break, maybe more off the backboard and trying for that alley-oop off the backboard of Washington. Wasn't there. Now the other way, losing control, but a nice pass there. Aleka losing control, ends up tipping it to Bolden for the deuce.
I tell you what, maybe this is the dunk in of the floor, the 8-foot goal, but it really does seem like this end of the floor is just dunks and layups. But the North has done a great job of canceling this run that the South was on. I made a couple of big shots. You can tell some of these players are really focusing on winning the game now.
The North leading 104-96 over the South. Remember, the North in the black jerseys, the South in the white. 143 and rolling, shot clock running down under five. It'll be up and off the glass. No good, fight for the rebound. And now the South has numbers. Will we see a pull up? No, dish off and for three from the corner. That around out, no good, but Bolden's there for the putback.
Showing the ability to finish around the basket, just doing a little bit of everything. Late game situations, that's what you want.
104-98, the North holding that 6-point lead. And now an offensive foul goes on Parks, got the elbows up, trying to clear space. And we'll go ahead and see the ball go the other way with the foul chance to get the lead down further. Timeout on the floor as we saw that call, and a lot of folks complained about that elbow call. We'll get to that one second, but again, we'll remind you, the Elite Showcase Basketball Classic features many of the premier players in the nation. Visit us at www.esbcbasketball.com. Junior, want to get your opinion on that. We see that a lot now, the clear out with the elbows getting called, trying to prevent concussions and those this awful-looking hits to the head. So I've heard a lot of folks, one of the big proponents, Doris Burke of ESPN, saying, hey, if the defense gets on you, what can you do to go ahead and get yourself a little bit of space?
Well, I tell you what, first of all, I'm a big Doris Burke fan, so I'm glad you brought it up. I've actually listened to her talk about this. This particular play that we're talking about, it just happened, isn't what she's talking about. There was enough space for this kid here to, you know, close through, to rip through without, but he's trying to send a message to the guard to relieve some of the pressure. What I'm having a problem is that when it's done intentionally, on purpose with some of the players that you absolutely know. You've been watching some of the games of the NCAA tournament. You've seen some of these elbows and et cetera. There's no reason to play around a kid's head. Bottom line, I've been playing a long time, and you know when you're doing something intentionally and when it's not intentional. You're trying to send a message, basically, what happens for big guys like myself. When a guard is trying to get the ball and you lead those elbows out, you know what you're looking at. You know what you're pointing to. I'm 6'8". A 6'1 guard comes around. I'm swinging my elbows through. I know exactly what I'm trying to do.
Gotcha.
And make no mistake about it, most of these kids do. But the problem is that when you're dealing with referees, a lot of times, and you know, we hate referees. When you're dealing with referees or officials in those calls, you have to be wary of, you know, they might not call the guy being too close, or they might call a flop charge call. So you have to create space just so you can play. So it's kind of a double-edged sword.
Another alley-oop attempt. That one doesn't go down, but Cox with it. Can't get it to go, but Washington comes with the rebound and now fought for, and it'll be saved. And they'll call it over and back as Savage eventually recovered it, but his foot on the line. So really, the South, after taking a shot that wasn't that good, other end, they dodge a bullet. They can go ahead and maybe cut this down to a one-possession game, trailing 104-98 with 45.7 left to go.
I think we'll make a rule here, and maybe we should talk to the coaches that over the last minute, if you're up 4 or 5 points, we'll stop trying to throw lobs. That would be a great situation for us.
Cook with the three attempt, no good. Rebound by Washington of the North squad. Tries to throw it in bounds to save it, and it will go ahead and lead to a break the other way as Cox had the night outlet, and now a foul will be given up on Parks as the South squad going to go ahead and send the North to the line and shoot some free throws to stay in the contest.
Way to rebound the basketball. Good shot by Cook. You know, it didn't go in. They just playing hard. The South was playing hard all the way to the very end. It's always nice to see.
Quickly, that went off and no good. And the South goes the other way, looking to go ahead and cut into the 6-point lead. Shot off the glass, no good. Rebound by Washington, shot clock off. We'll see if they go ahead and let them play it out. I think they're going to go ahead and give up the foul, so they will. That'll be Bolden. He'll go ahead and they'll send them to the line. So it'll be Park shooting the free throws. Junior, any idea maybe on a player of the game for you?
I like the big fella. I'm always going to go big guy. I like Cox. I like Cox Ford. He's dominated the game on both ends. He's been as advertised. His engine has been on the entire time. He's been rebounding, defensive, offensive rebounds. I would give it to Cox if I had an opportunity to give out that trophy. But obviously Mason's been very good too. So I wouldn't be surprised if he got it. But big guy bias.
Yeah, I think right now we have Cox down for an unofficial 22 points, which I believe is the leading score in the contest. So probably a good choice, but you're right. A lot of guys who are deserving of that. We'll see who, if they give it to. And now it'll be a slam given there by Marshall Wood. He'll cut it down to 108-98, but that should do it. We'll see. They will go ahead and give a foul up here. But I think really pretty much academic right now as the North goes ahead and gets themselves a win in this contest. And really some good play by both squads and really a nice event for these guys to show what they can do.
I'll tell you what. Obviously it started off a little shaky. We've been here from the very beginning.
Uh-huh.
But to see how this game has come close, it's a 100 to 106 game right now. It goes to show that some of these coaches were able to do a few things as far as changing who was on the floor, putting the right chemistry together out there. And that's always good to see from a coaching aspect. But to see some of these players taking it seriously and taking better shots and making better decisions late in the game.
Last shot up, that will not count. Our final, the North gets the victory, 106-2. They will go ahead and put it on the board, 106-102. But that's not the important thing. The important thing, Junior, we saw some very good players out here. A lot of guys going on to some big schools, and I think a lot of guys that we'll be seeing playing that NCAA tournament and some big-time tournaments as they go through their college careers.
Absolutely, and it's an honor for me to be here to get an opportunity to see some of them at the very beginning of their careers. I mean, I know their high school careers are over, but this is where it starts, and this is where the fun begins. Does your talent translate? Are you willing to improve in certain areas that you weren't able to improve in high school? And you'll be able to see some of these kids because of some of the big schools they're going to. They'll be on ABC, CBS, ESPN, and it'll be a great opportunity for you to see a bunch of the kids you've seen.
Yeah, and really, guys, you are very deserving of what they've been able to do. We mentioned it with Moali Cox with the 22 points. On the other side, Daquan Cook and Brandon Bolden both with 18 in the matchup. Frank Mason had a big game as well for the North side. So those are some guys you're talking about. And really some guys who may not be headed to the biggest schools but will get to go ahead and do some good things. Let's get down to Daniel.
I'm here with Coach Carter of the winning North team. Coach, they made a run there at the end, but what did it take to pull it out?
Our guys, we just played with effort, determination. They switched it up from man and went to a zone, and we had a tough time identifying the zone and how to handle it, but once we got in the flow, we came through.
Well, congratulations on the win, Coach. Tillman, you're going to Navy next year. What made you pick Navy?
The coaching staff, mainly. They just came from Penn State, and Coach DeChellis just coached Taylor Battle, who's a great point guard. So if you could work hard with Taylor Battle, I mean, he could do the same for me. So,
although you guys couldn't pull out the victory today, how much fun was it to play out there with those guys?
Extremely fun. It was my first All-Star game. Now I get another one. That's a Capital Classic. So it's nice just to be out here with guys who love basketball as much as I do. So it's just fun.
Well, congratulations to you. Now, Moali Cox, you're going to VCU next year with Coach Shaka Smart. There was a little bit of controversy whether he was going to stay or not. What was going through your mind there?
I felt like he was going to stay all the way. Like, he just signed a big contract last year. A lot of schools were offering, so I felt like it was the same situation. So I felt comfortable.
Well, I just heard you're the MVP of this game. What was it like to play in it, and how much fun was it?
I mean, it was real fun. I play against these dudes all summer, all the time, high school. So it was fun to finally play with them. We stay in the same hotel. We just had lots of fun this weekend.
Well, congratulations on the MVP and good luck in the future at VCU.
All right, thank you.
Yep, back to you guys.
Thank you, Daniel. And it will be Moali Cox, as Daniel said. I believe also Frank, maybe been co-MVPs. We saw Frank Mason getting a trophy out at center court. He also had 22 points by our unofficial stats. So those two guys really got some things going, but some other guys that really played very well. I guess your final thoughts on the matchup today and some of the guys we saw out here.
Well, like I said, like we talked about throughout the game, this has been a very well-played All-Star game. I mean, obviously there are going to be some turnovers and some bad plays. But from the very beginning, you can tell that some of these kids want to come out and show their talent. and just do a couple of things that everybody else could really just get an opportunity to see. Some of the undecided kids obviously played well in this whole game, Aaron Parks and Ali. So you just really wanted and very pleased to see some of these kids playing hard, giving a whole lot of effort, well coached on both ends. I'm pleased with what I saw today. Looking forward to seeing some of these kids play over the next couple of years. Very excited. Mo Ali should also be explained that that contract that Shaka Smart signed, there are bigger contracts out there. Maybe somebody explain that to him. Hopefully Coach Smart stays down there for him. And he helps Coach Smart be more successful, which in turn will give him a bigger contract to stay down there at VCU. So.
Well, I'll tell you what, though. He is going to be a very good fit at that school, as a lot of these guys are going to be good fits at where they're going to end up. I want to remind you, again, that you can purchase a copy of the broadcast at www.synthesismp.com. And remember, the Elite Basketball Classic features many of the premier players in the nation. Visit their website at www.esbcbasketball.com. That's esbcbasketball.com. Plenty of folks to thank in this one. Again, our camera guys, Nick Plum, Jeff Keselowski, great today. Our sideline reporter, Daniel Zimmet. Also, our analyst, Junior Burrow. Thanks so much,
thank
Junior.
You so
it was
much.
Great working with you.
Honored
and also, our technical director and executive producer, BJ Kubaralis. I'm Jeremy Huber. Again, the North knocks off the South in the Elite Basketball Classic of 2012. Good night, everybody.
Good night.